We are reacting to John Doyle's new video called Top 5 Stupidest Baby Boomer Talking Points, and we're going to let him machine gun his way. Through his
to touch on the liberalism statism video that should probably be expanded upon beforehand, and I was already planning on making this video anyway, so I figured that it would be better to put a couple videos out this week, which can kind of lay some of the foundation for what's going to be explored next week. And so today we are going to go over the top 5 stupidest baby boomer talking points. We will explain the concept of the boomer, why we have an issue with them, but also why we love them, how these talking points have enabled the destruction of our country, and I'm sure that you're familiar with all of them, so do stay tuned.
Guys, let me know if double speed is too fast for you. I know John speaks pretty quick already, but I watch everything in double speed. I think big brain people need to take a page or a note from me and go ahead and watch everything in double speed.
You're so funny. I've never spent time with someone like you before, Anon.
What the?
We always have so much fun. You're such a great friend. Anyways, thanks for the coffee. Have you met my new boyfriend?
Get out of your date.
Black person expert. Ear rape. This is the most weird meta thing in the world, but okay, I like it. New animation style, classic intro, no critique so far. Okay.
Hello there, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Heck Off Commie. Let us address the baby boomer question. Let us first, though, remind the audience that the Discord server is back up on the website, so if you're a member, go to the website, join the boys once again. Also, look how much better the image looks. Is this not better? Are the angles not better? Are the lights not better? Our friend Kayla came over, got everything set up properly, so we appreciate that. We love Kayla, don't we, folks? Also, the new merch is going live on the website this weekend for the 3-year anniversary of the channel, so be ready for that. But anyways, yeah, some of us watching are baby boomers, some of us have parents who are boomers, maybe even have grandparents who are boomers, and technically speaking, a baby boomer is someone who was born between the years 1945 and 1965, and ironically, the name of the generation, which is in reference to the post-World War II surge in babies that this country had because we were riding an unprecedented wave of prosperity and morale, ironically, the name even references their greatest weakness, which is exactly that they grew up in the most prosperous and free period in the history of the country, probably even the history of the world, and they piss it away. And I've said this before, they were too busy getting high and listening to Led Zeppelin IV to actually push back against the forces which have ultimately overtaken our country. And let me clarify, I don't think that my generation's better. I recognize that, you know, every generation's gonna have its problems. We don't even know how to cook or fix household appliances, but, you know, at least we didn't fumble the greatest lead in civilizational history. I don't know, that's just my opinion. And if, you know, me and all the young people are arrogant, we think we know it all, we don't even know how to fix a toilet, maybe you should raise this better. I don't know. That's what always makes me laugh, because they'll say, well, kids nowadays, they have to get a participation trophy for everything. What happened to earning things? Like, who do you think is buying the participation trophies for us, dude? Like, who's picking them up from the store? It's not us, because we are 5. The point being that I know that not all baby boomers are like this. Truth be told, I actually really like baby boomers, and we're really gonna miss them in a few decades, assuming the current trends continue. But that being said, given that it was that generation who ceded all institutional power to the communists, and it was that generation who was in power while the managed decline of our country was largely set into place, I do feel somewhat righteously indignant. But anyways, technically a boomer is someone who was born between 45 and 65, but I believe that it's more of a cultural thing. Like, I know 60-year-old boomers and I know 30-year-old boomers, because that which defines the boomer is the inability to recognize that things have changed. That's what it is. And I mean no disrespect by that. Like, every generation is always gonna have a point where they don't really understand what the younger generations are doing. But when we talk about baby boomers, like, that tends to be the implication, that you're dealing with someone who just doesn't get it. And that's why people my age are zoomers, because we don't have time to not get it. So we gotta move speedy quick, or else we're all gonna end up in mass graves. And one of the greatest examples of this recently, this was at a protest I attended last November. This was the day after the fortified election, and I went down to downtown Detroit where they were counting the ballots for legitimately elected President Joseph Robinette Biden Jr. Some of you actually might even remember watching the live stream that I did at this event. We were in this crowd of people, most of them baby boomers, and there was this huge crowd of people across the street from us who were protesting our protest. And as you can imagine in Detroit, this group of people were largely, that's right, they were largely Democrats. And so I'm watching these Democrats. I'll never forget this, because something like just clicked for me in this moment, because there was this one particularly boisterous young Democrat woman who was screaming at us, and, you know, she started a series of chants that said, like, F white people, F America, F Donald Trump. And then one of the guys on our side, who was a baby boomer, he was dressed up as a founding father, tricorn hat and all, he got to the front of us, and he turns around, he raises his hands, and then he begins to lead us in song. He wanted us all to sing God Bless America to drown these people out. And that's when it clicked. This guy meant well, he loves his country, he's probably a good man. But he just doesn't get it. And that explains why our country's collapsing, because you have people who think that the answer to I hate you because of your skin color, I hate your country, and we took over your entire country, and are going to punish you beyond your worst expectations. And they think the answer to that is, let's sing patriotic songs. That'll change their mind. Do you think they're confused when they say that they hate you and they hate America? They really mean that. You're not going to sway them with a folk song. Oh. And then at that point, I just said, screw it. I'm going to use actual tactics against these people because song isn't working. So I decided to capitalize on low impulse control, a known Democrat weakness, to see if I could get some of them arrested. So I had my megaphone, and I just started broadcasting to that particularly boisterous Democrat woman stuff like, hey, are you from Little Caesars? Because you're hot and I'm ready. And right on cue, she starts crossing the street screaming at me. The police see this. They start calling after her. The plan's coming together. And then from left field, this Asian girl comes up to me and the boys, and she gets right in our face, and she's like, you guys are being so disrespectful and rude to her. I'm on your side, but this is so immature. And then it clicked again. Then I tried to pull this epic prank to get this woman arrested by simply complimenting her with a reference to a Michigan-based pizza franchise. This woman who was literally chanting, F white people, I hate you, come over here so we can beat your ass. Now I have this little Asian feminist telling me that I'm the problem. And say what you will about conservative women, but if you as a woman approach a man like this and get in his face, that's internalized feminism, whether you realize it or not. Women shouldn't ever approach a man like that. Frankly, if you do, you should expect to be treated like a man. Let's do that actually, right now. You want to know the correct take on hitting women? Here it is. The whole idea behind not hitting women, as a general rule, everybody knows, you know, women are your mothers, they're your sisters, they're these vivacious, feminine, nurturing beings. We have to protect them because of that, right? It's not because they're physically weak. That's what everybody thinks, but that's not why. There are plenty of physically weak men that no one would have a problem with hitting. And I think about this because I saw a clip from an anti-jab mandate protest last weekend, headlined by Nick Fuentes, where this woman got right up in this guy's face and started yelling at him, like a joke or something. And I just rolled my eyes at this because it's like, yeah, okay, girl boss, you're not tough. The only reason that you're doing that is because you know that you can operate with total impunity because you're a woman. For the most part, no man would ever just get up in another man's face like that unless there was really a problem, because he knows that the threat of violence is always on the table. And the worst part, not this crowd, but the average crowd. If this guy even pushed back at this woman, like, just pushed her back, you would have heard all the white knights fall into place. How dare you put your hands on a woman? Don't you ever touch a girl? Okay, well, if you want the benefits and protections of being a woman, then you have to behave like a woman. Those are the rules. If you start behaving like a man, you will be treated like a man. And this is off topic, but it's tied to the broader point of what feminism has done to this country in just 100 years. We're going to touch on that a little bit more in a second. But when you pretend that men and women are equal, which is not the case, you necessarily have to give women power over men to achieve the desired equal outcome. So now women are free to get in your face, they can scream at you, they can push you, but if you even raise your voice to them, they'll cry and file domestic violence charges against you. It is literally giving women a license to operate with total impunity and total advantage in every aspect of life, whether it's the courts, the workplace, universities, everywhere. But they still get to retain their status as the eternal victims because of weak men with mommy issues who think white knighting will get them late. right. Think about that. We live in a society that has artificially elevated women to such a pedestal that most men don't even realize the conditioning. And then when a guy like me comes out, when a guy like me speaks honestly about women, they short circuit. What? This guy's not simping? Well, he needs to get laid. He's an incel, and it's pathetic because they can only conceptualize existence as a man in terms of getting access to women's bodies. Their existence as men is derived and validated from the approval of women, a complete inversion of how things should be, and they can't even grasp the idea of not being locked into that framework. Oh, you said something mean about women? You must be an incel. Yeah, okay, hope she sees it, bro. Hope she sees that. Hope she gives you a crumb. You need to get laid. You need to go to church. We're off topic. There were two clicks for me in that story. We had the tricorn hat boomer and MAGA waifu, who's actually really sweet girl. I don't mean to put her on the spot, but understand my mindset at the time, just watching all of this happen around me. We had the two clicks. We went click, click, and then I blew my head off in Tetris. And even now, I'm gonna get people who are like, John, I usually agree with you, but you should never put your hands on a girl. Yeah, frankly, that rule is outdated and stupid. Women don't act like women anymore. And if I saw a woman get a guy's face, screaming at him, pushing him, hitting him, and he like pushed her away from him, maybe even did a little bit more, maybe did a little Sean Connery mode, I can't say I'm gonna pretend that he's somehow less of a man for that. Like, yeah, being a real man is letting a woman abuse you in public. In fact, I'd probably buy him a beer. And again, obviously, women should be protected. My point is simply that they can't have their cake and eat it too. That is all. But anyway.
That took him, what, like 10 minutes to get to the fucking point? Oh my God. Okay. I mean, I agree. You know, women obviously think, oh, I, you know, man, it makes your blood boil. You know, a woman gets up to your face, bitches at you, like, really? Like, know your place. Just shut the fuck up, right? Like, imagine if you were in jail or you were next to a cop and you're tongue lashing some, like, 6'5", 230-pound jock, okay? Like, you know you're only doing that because you know that there's no legal recourse against what you're doing. So women go up to you and be nasty as hell, knowing you can't hit them. And, you know, you got to, like, buy their bluff sometimes. Like John said, you know what, bitch? Because, honestly, they take it too far. There has to be a pendulum swing. And by a pendulum swing, maybe I mean a backhanded swing. I don't know.
Anyways, we get back to baby boomers. Obviously, hindsight's 2020, but had they really put up a fight against the internal threats that this country was facing, we wouldn't be in this position. And I really think that's what's going on with their patriotism, with their patriotic songs, all of that. I really think it's a mixture of not realizing that the country they grew up in is long gone, and that it will be a miracle if we can get it back, and also, like, a coping mechanism for maybe subconsciously realizing that and just trying to drown it out with the over-the-top patriotism for patriotism's sake. Like, I'm patriotic, I love America, but not in its current form, and people don't understand that. Like, I criticize America in its current form, and people think I'm anti-American, that I'm giving up on America. And it's like, aren't you guys the same people who make fun of the body positivity movement and say, like, well, we shouldn't be promoting unhealthy lifestyles and unhealthy choices? Aren't you the ones who say, well, you need to pull yourselves up by your bootstraps and take responsibility? If you have a family member who's a heroin addict, you probably wouldn't spend all your time talking about how great they are and how, in a way, a heroin addiction is actually what makes them great because it was their choice to become a heroin addict or something. No, the point being that if you love something, you have to hate that which threatens it. And if you want to solve a problem, you have to identify correctly. And I love America and I hate the problems with it. And that's my life goal, to make those problems disappear as best I can. A lot of people just want to wave American flags and sing songs and pretend that everything's fine because it makes them personally feel better, but I actually take this very seriously. I'm not going to apologize for that. So we will now get into the list. You know, my friend Blake said something one time that made me laugh. He said, it's not a hawk video unless the list doesn't start until 10 minutes in. And it's so true.
12 minutes.
We just have a lot to say. Had to tell some stories, had to talk about hitting women. Lots on the docket today. But before we get into the list, have you noticed that it's getting crazier out there? Yes? Well, that is because it is getting crazier out there. And more and more of you are...
his endorsements or whatever are pretty cool as ads. You know, he's selling, what, pistol holsters? Okay.
The line of thinking tends to suggest that this division is being manufactured rather than being exploited, which is what's actually happening. Because if you know anything about history, you know anything about human nature, about in-group preference, etc., you know that these divisions between people are inevitable, like literally unavoidable. There's never been a successful multiracial, multi-ethnic, multicultural society operating under a liberal framework in the history of the world. Like, we are...
No multiracial, multi-ethnic society in the liberal framework in history. Okay, well, that's a good question because you could mention a lot of societies that were multicultural that lasted decades, if not centuries, but then he would say, well, they weren't liberal. And to that you would say, well, I mean, what was liberal pre-1700? Most countries and empires were pre-1700. So, I mean, really... I don't know. I mean, South Africa's multi-ethnic. Obviously, that didn't work out. India's multi-ethnic, if you actually look into it, and they're doing fine. China's multi-ethnic, but they're, you know, genociding the Uyghurs or whatever. I don't care, but that is what it is. Let me think of what else. Russia's multi-ethnic, but are they liberal? Not really. What else is multi-ethnic? You could argue that Spain is multi-ethnic. Obviously... the supermajority Spanish population really trumps the Asturians and the Barcelonan people and the people that are in the Basque region. And I'm being a smartass, but let me be very thorough. What else? Canada's multi-ethnic. They're going downhill, though. America's obviously going downhill. The Mexicans, you could argue, are multi-ethnic, as in they're different racial groups, but they're all Spanish-speaking. Brazil is very diverse. But that's going downhill as well. But there was a trajectory that was going up like 70 years ago. So keep that in mind. Very nuanced question, though.
We are experimenting with it right now. You tell me how you think it's going. I don't know. But this gets back into the well-meaning patriot who wishes so badly that everyone in the world would just come together under the American flag and sing the songs and love his country just as much as he does and be just as American as him. But unfortunately, that's just not the way that these things work. I wish it were, but it isn't. These immigrants are not coming here and reading the Federalist Papers and voting to preserve the foundations of this country. Lots of them do.
Most white people,
but the vast majority are not doing that. The vast majority just view America as an economic opportunity, which I guess they feel entitled to since Americans decided that temporary incessant displays of patriotism from third world immigrants to satisfy their egos was worth like our national identity and purpose being reduced to a glorified casino. And they vote based on their group identity to achieve as much power for it as possible. So that's the reality. So it's not that the people in charge are creating this division by fanning the flames in the media, it's that they are exploiting the division that they created, that they knew was an inexorable consequence of importing tens of millions of people from the third world into this country over the course of the last 60 years. That's the correct take. The take isn't, they're trying to divide us by these things. We must unite. What are you, John Lennon? You think that would be winning? There is nothing that the ruling class would like more than a population of people with no culture, no national identity, no religion, no anything. Just a peasant class of perpetual consumers. And that's why they stripped all that away from you in the first place. But anyways, we continue. Number two, who are you to enforce your morality on others? John Doyle's just like a leftist. If you don't agree with his morality, he says you're a bad person. Yes, that is correct. But the difference is that I'm right and they're wrong. And I get that you've been conditioned by decades of liberal propaganda to reject the ideas of right and wrong and to believe that everything is relative, but I think that we've seen the results of that experiment, and they suggest that it's time to go back to how things used to be. So yeah, not only is there right from wrong, and not only do we know right from wrong, but we have an obligation to use our power, whether that's our voices or laws, to promote good in society. Well, I don't believe it's the government's job to compel individual behavior, really. Basically every law that exists does exactly that. Speed limits, which I ironically think should be abolished. We should have some sort of like system where you can buy like a pass or maybe like $1,000 a year to let you drive however you want to, however fast you want to, I should say. The speed limits do that. Murder laws, sexual assault laws, they all compel individual behavior. So the question becomes, where do you draw the line? If you don't trust yourself to know right from wrong and to advocate for right and against wrong, then how can you support laws against murder or rape or anything, really? And if your answer to that is anarchy, then you're no different than a socialist because you're fixated on these impractical utopian ideas. The bottom line is that this country and everything about it that you love so much was built upon Christianity. That's the fact of the matter. You might not like it, but it's nonetheless true. The reason you have God-given rights is because of that. The reason this country isn't as lost as Australia right now is because of that. How can you talk about your rights as an American that you only have because of God while rejecting the concept of objective morality which exists through God? The only reason people don't like this is because they get whiny. They get whiny when you highlight their moral behavior. Call me out of touch, call me a Puritan, which by the way isn't an insult. This country is moral.
How does that even make sense though? Okay. So America was founded on Christianity, which is why Australia is worse than us, but that doesn't make sense because, I mean, if I understand him right, the Australians were founded by virtually the same people that founded America, you know, 100 years after the fact. So I don't know what he's getting at. You know, the same Englishmen that founded America were more or less the same ones that founded Australia, parts of South Africa, etc., Canada. So to say, oh, well, Australia was set up different, that's why it failed. Not really. And a lot of the issues of Australia have been a thing, you know, of the last 50 years, not something that has been inherent, you know, in the 1920s when they were really prospering, if anything. So I don't know what he's going towards. And plus, to be even more specific, the U.S. was founded by mostly Protestant white Anglo-Saxons, whereas Australia was founded by mostly white Protestant Anglo-Saxons. So it's not even like Australia was Catholic or anything, but John's Catholic either way, so I don't know.
Culture back when it existed was largely influenced by the Puritans. That was a good thing. But the point is that we know what's good and we know what's bad, and if we want to have a good society instead of this like amoral vacuum of nihilism, then we have to actually stand up for good and against bad. This should be self-evident. But we continue. Number three, your problem is that you're thinking with emotion, not logic. Policies need to be judged on their results, not their intentions. Again, yes, this is true, but it doesn't really serve a purpose beyond making whoever said it feel smug, because it misunderstands the reality of human nature, which is that people basically don't have agency and are not robots. Even if I were governed exclusively by facts and logic above all else, there would still have to be something inside of me that created that fixation. Think about it. People are not driven by facts and logic. Even you are not driven by facts and logic. This fixation on abstractions has undermined
smug autism.
We're driven by the fact that we love this country. Look at the passion. Look at the passion that these protesters and rioters have. Look at the way they scream, the way that they cry and take to the streets. Do you seriously believe that if you sat down with them and proved to them that you were correct on gun control, gun policy, that the very next day they'd be back out there, except this time they'd be channeling that passion in favor of your side? No, they'd probably just say, well, I just have to do more research, and then just stick to what they already believe. Lived experiences, passions, these are the things that compel people. These are the things that compel people to fight, right? Politics isn't about truth. It should be. It's not. It's about people, and people are prideful. They are ego-invested into these things. They're largely influenced by their lived experiences. And if you can structure a society that basically breeds mental illness and then simultaneously create victim narratives for people to sympathize with, you could consolidate a decent amount of power pretty quickly, couldn't you? There's a reason that these people like break down into tears when you debate with them. And the grand irony is that you laugh at them as if they're the ones who don't get what's going on. No, you don't get what's going on. You don't get how bad things in this country are, where these people are so sick that they can't have a disagreement about politics without literally crying, and you think it's just because you like own them so hard with facts and logic. No, you don't get it. And these people are dangerously close to having total power over you. You think that they're just gonna leave you alone? They're not. And again, this doesn't mean that we should be thinking with emotions and ignore facts. This is just to say that we have to be honest with our situation, and if we want to win, we have to simultaneously figure out how to cure widespread societal nihilism while configuring our policies or reconfiguring them, I should say, to appeal to people's emotions and experiences instead of, frankly, their pride. Like, hey, smart people only talk about facts and logic. So if you want to be a smart person like me, only talk about facts and logic. That's not how you take a country back. That's how you make a substantial personal fortune by declaring that there are only two genders, basically. But we continue. Number four.
Whoa,
this is too far. We need to go back to insert previous stage of liberalism that was predicted to lead to this. And this is always the case. Third wave feminism is too far. But I like original feminism. Critical race theory is too far. But I like Martin Luther King Jr. He wouldn't have supported this, really. The astroturf communist activist Martin Luther King Jr., who wrote his journals about things exactly like critical race theory, he wouldn't have supported it, really. Then why will the veterans of the civil rights movement who march alongside him, why do they support it? That's the red pill most conservatives are not ready for, the MLK pill. Oh, but John, MLK advocated for peaceful demonstrations. Oh, like peaceful protests? Who told you that? Your public school history teacher? Just like Antifa is just an idea, right? Just like 93% of Black Lives Matter protests 2 summers ago were peaceful, right? Do you understand that almost everything you were ever taught about history is a lie? They're writing the history books because they won, and as they keep winning and writing history.
That is such an amazing point that most people don't understand. When they say Martin Luther King was this like sort of saint-like figure, you know, venerated like George Washington, I mean, it is duplicitous, you know, that to say on one hand that the white segregationist were just complete bitter assholes that just hated blacks for no valid reason. And then to say, oh, but the blacks, oh, poor blacks that were being sprayed down, they were getting bitten by dogs. Like, why do you think that fucking happened? There must have been a valid reason, okay? You honestly think, oh, well, George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, they were so in line. These guys were so based. These guys were so ahead of their time. And yet their great grandkids in the South couldn't figure race out? I mean, that is asinine. I mean, there must have been a valid reason for segregation, and maybe they were wrong. Probably they were. But there's nuances to it, but they don't teach you that. They just say, you know, George Wallace was an asshole. These white people are crazy. God knows why. And these poor black people, and they never committed violence, except for Malcolm X, who did actually, you know, go against the white liberal establishment. But no, the token right here, the House Negro, MLK. No, this guy's solid. This guy's good. You know, overlook him having affairs and orgies in hotel rooms, even though he's supposed to be a deacon or something. Okay? Ignore that. And go for, I have a dream. Like, shut the fuck up, dude. Really? All these conservatarians making my blood boil. You know, MLK is probably on par with most politicians insofar as how dirty the guy is, perverted, etc. And he's overrated. And even if he was a peaceful protest guy, everybody around him was not, okay? When you look at the Black Panthers, what did Martin Luther King do to stifle that, okay? When we're looking at Gaddafi, how come Martin Luther King didn't have poignant opinions about African leaders at the time and denounce those that some mass marketed? Or, for example, the fact that, like John said, there was critical race theory already being fomented in the Martin Luther King sphere of things as early as the 1960s and 70s, and yet nobody talks about that. Why? Because, you know, public education in general is very left, and a lot of conservatives just take whatever was taught pre-1990 and just assume that it was legit. Like, shut the fuck up. No, it wasn't.
History books, your kids are going to be taught that Antifa and Black Lives Matter are just ideas that are peaceful, and my sons, all seven of them, are going to have to red pill your kids, and then you're going to witness history repeating itself, because people online in the 2050s will be writing, the mass execution of conservatives is not what Black Lives Matter was about. As a George Floyd conservative, that's literally what's going to happen, George Floyd conservatism. And I'll say this about boomers, because it's a double-edged sword, since they can't accept that things have changed. So like on the one hand, they're like, no, we just need small government, and Ronald Reagan, and the Cold War still happening, etc., etc. But on the other hand, you can never get them to buy into something like gender theory. Like, I don't buy it either, but at least I understand what they're saying, right? Like the philosophical question of what defines manhood, womanhood, do they intersect? Like, I get what they're saying, but boomers just go, no, it's male or female, basic biology, and I love that about them. We're going to miss that a lot. If you think that this country is going down with boomers holding power, just wait until millennials start replacing them in the next 10 years, then we're really going to be screwed, glued, and tattooed. But I bring that up because I was talking about something related to this with my mom the other day, and she goes, well, what do you think about Martin Luther King Jr.? And I go, you think I like Martin Luther King? And she goes, well, I don't know. You know, my brother never liked him. And I was like, let's flipping go. Base Uncle Rob, the Maverick strikes again. But here's the point. We don't like feminism because it is the complete inversion of reality. It is built upon the idea that man and woman are equal. Not that they should be treated with equal dignity, but like literally that they are equal. That is untrue. That is unnatural. And it's actually satanic, which could be why, less than 100 years later, child sacrifice is completely normalized in our culture. But when you accept that idea, then anything else is totally.
Oh, abortion is child sacrifice. I think he's being a little ironic.
Fair game, because you have established a slope, okay. And it's a slippery one, as you can clearly see by this point, or even MLK, same thing. The principles enshrined by the civil rights movement were expected to have consequences, and exactly what was predicted has come true. What happens when you legally enshrine equality, not just between men and women, but everyone? And then when that equality doesn't happen, because not everyone's equal, you get things like critical race theory. Affirmative action, all of it, it's unavoidable. So it's not enough to say, well, we just need to get back to earlier stages of liberal ideas, because those ideas are what led to this in the first place. And the reason people even think that in the first place is because of the liberal conditioning that they've been experiencing for their entire lives. Well, you know what, John? Maybe I am a liberal. Well, then maybe you're the problem. Yeah, I already knew that. I already knew that you're not conservative. That's why we're here in the first place. Anyways, last one. This one's actually my least favorite. Oh, just you wait and see. Just red wave imminence. It's like this eternal fixation on being as smug as possible. I just don't get it. I feel like I'm chaperoning children when I listen to these.
Whoa.
If Joe Biden does a vaccine mandate, it'll actually be racist against black people since they're the least likely to get vaccinated. Joe Biden let all these people from Latin America come into the country, but then when some Haitian people came in, he started sending them back. So in other words, it was only when black people started showing up that he had a problem with it.
Oh my god. Okay, that laugh was cringe. You did hear that shit. Well, anyway, this is a funny screenshot of John Doyle. I need to take a picture of this with my iPhone. No way, bro. This is funny. Okay, so basically, he says red wave imminent, so smugness is a man's final state. He's like, oh, I gotta, you know, babysit these guys. Who just released a video called Red Wave Imminent, leftist pollster has Biden down negative 15? Red Eagle Politics just made a video called Red Wave Imminent, ? Or whatever. And then John, you know, shits on that. Like, come on, John. I disavow that. Red Eagle's right. Red Wave is imminent. I don't know why you're hating so much, John. And look, to be frank, there is a red wave. It's going to happen. And there's nothing smug about it. And Red Eagle points out very clearly the Republicans aren't where they are supposed to be, though they are the better alternative over the Democrats, as we can all agree this. And if you don't, then you're retarded. But that's okay. You you say, oh, you know, I have to babysit y'all. Like, okay, no, Red Eagle does not need to be babysat, okay? The guy is based, and on most issues, not as much as I am, of course, but ultimately, he knows better. He knows that he's never made this argument before, you know, post-2020. Obviously, I had to set him straight on some issues, but pre-2019, we can argue about that, but as of the 2020 election, Red Eagle has never used, like, the Democrats are being racist. I mean, that is retarded. I don't hear anybody saying that. You know, you have boneheads, baldheads, skinheads, like Jack Murphy, bearded weirdo. I don't hear him saying that. Ben Shapiro, does he say that the Haitian deportation is racist? I don't hear this talking point. Maybe Diamond and Silk, but nobody takes him seriously as a movement. I don't think Crowder's saying that. So I don't know where he's getting this from. And he's mocking, you know, appeal to blacks. And to me, I think that appealing to blacks could have some promise. I think not appealing to black women are over, they're canceled. There's no way we're going to get their vote. Fuck them. Electorally, I don't think we're going to get more than 10% of the black woman vote, so don't even try. Okay? Just leave them alone. Same thing with certain white people, you know. If you have dyed hair and you're white, just fuck off. I mean, you're probably not going to click with us. Now, what I will say about black men is that there's a niche of black men who are in the middle class that will probably cleave onto the Republican Party given enough time. Now, civil rights is within our lifetimes, or at least for boomers. So you can see a lot of black old people vote Democrat, but like going forward, there's some promise for black males.
Do you think you're cute? Like, you think that this is clever? Oh, I'm gonna operate within the left's moral framework and then pretend that I'm winning because this time I get to call them the racist. You're actually a child. Like, I'm sorry, but this is true. Like, this is so sophomoric. Like, what a real conservative you are when the best argument that you can think of against vaccine mandates is that it would be unfair to black people. The biggest one, though, this idea of the silent majority. Just you wait and see. When Carter was in office, we had inflation. We had gas prices through the roof. And then people got mad. And then Reagan came and swept the country and it was a landslide. Oh, just you wait. The same thing's happening now with Biden. Just you wait. Trump's gonna come back and history's gonna repeat itself. Really? The country that has become about 50% less trusting of its own people and about 25% less white since 1980, that's the country that's gonna have a Republican landslide in the federal election. White people are the only demographic that by majority vote for Republicans. We've been winning federal elections by small margins every cycle because of immigration, because of demographic change. Everybody knows this. The left celebrates this. This is not all controversial. Are you going to change their minds with what institutional power? Do you think that this country is unified enough to have an election? Be a landslide, let alone...
Yes, because... Okay. John doesn't get the proportions mathematically right, and I think that's because he doesn't look into electoral, you know, stuff in general, which is, you know, again, that's not his lane, but he should stay out of this one. Now, in terms of the white demographic going down, that's not really the biggest issue we have right now. And yes, in 2019, pre-COVID... the demography and the lack of white birth rates and conservative birth rates in general, but I mean, you know, increasing Hispanic population, all that, that was a problem. But as of right now, that's not really the biggest issue. From 2016 to 2020, sure, did the white population go down maybe like 2%? Sure. But honestly, keep in mind the fact that that the actual electoral share of the white vote goes down less in proportion than does the country, because the turnout for the Hispanics, which are the majority of the immigrants, is not as high. The Asian turnout isn't as high. So you can import a million Hispanic immigrants, but less than half of them are going to vote. So given that fact, so immigration historically has been about a million immigrants a year. That's about 0.3% of the population. So given that fact, we're looking at the electorate change like 0.2% every year, give or take. So if the electorate is changing less than a year, that means that Trump's odds of winning from 2020 to 2024 isn't changing more than 5% based off of demography. So if anything, we need to worry about the suburbs first before immigration, believe it or not. Not immigration. Again, I'm against immigration in general, but emphasizing all the white people are losing the majority, like, that's not a big deal right now. That's probably like a number 10 issue right now. 2 years ago, I would have answered different. But this is a different situation we have now with the virus and the lockdowns, all this sort of garbage. Yes, so Donald Trump could definitely win 2024 by a lot, assuming there's no shenanigans, of course. But yeah, no, landslide? I mean, 328 electoral votes and a popular vote victory by 1 or 2 points is, to me, a landslide politically, insofar as like the odds against him would be amazing. But yeah. Now, oh, we're not going to get a Reagan landslide? Shut the fuck up, dude. Who cares? Who needs that? Nobody's saying that, by the way. Come on.
It'd be a Republican? No, that country's long gone. And frankly, it's because of the boomers. Even more frankly, the greatest generation. They didn't defend it competently. They just don't get it. They and their parents grew up in the most prosperous generation in human history. You lived in leisure, then you let this happen. Perhaps understandably, after having come out of World War II, which we shouldn't have even been involved in the first place anyways. Frankly, that's another red pill that people aren't ready for. The World War II dissertation imminent, perhaps. But in summary, we are living...
Oh, my God. This is going to be an entire video. But, I mean, if he ever... does a World War II dissertation, I'm definitely going to hop on his ass, no homo, because, like, I mean, and I was debating Vince Dow on this, and he even resorted to saying that we shouldn't have intervened in World War II until a certain point, and I think that was pretty cringe. So John doesn't think so either, unironically. So I suppose we could have let the Nazis take over the vast majority of Europe. We could have let the Soviets probably lose to the Nazis as well and have most of Eurasia be conquered by the Germans. We could have also had the British starved to death, and we could have also had, you know, Australia, Hawaii, the Philippines, etc., China, controlled by Japan. I think, yeah, and then we could have just been constantly warding off invasions from the Japs and whoever the fuck, you know, in California, Alaska, etc., and we could be playing defense in the East Coast from German submarines and America bombers and all that. Yes. So, again, to say that we shouldn't have intervened in World War II, I mean, that is asinine. And the best explanation you could ever make up would be, like, well, in principle, or second of all, oh, well, if we never poked our head on diplomacy, then the Nazis wouldn't have gotten power, or the Japs wouldn't have gotten power. Like, that's asinine as well. So, come on.
Living through the direct result of a decadent mindset. You cannot expect to be apathetic, to be amoral, and just for everything to sustain itself. Do we now understand the results of the little sit back and do nothing experiment? Those types of people are not going to be in control anymore, and they don't deserve to be. We are going to take this country back, and we are going to do so by putting people with spines into power, as opposed to putting people without spines into power who pretend that their cowardice or indifference is some sort of virtue. This is a song about the leader of our movement, who 30 years ago today went to go buy something from the store. The nanny today said that he was using counterfeit currency, but when you think about it, fiat currency is just as valuable as fake currency, and the police didn't like that. So they killed him. Because he was an Austrian economics guy, just like us. His name was George Floyd. And today, we commemorate the loss of the face of modern conservatism, George Floyd. Where are you? And I'm so sorry. I cannot sleep, cannot dream tonight. I need somebody in all ways. This fentanyl's toxic, like surprisingly toxic, it's a problem. And as I stared, I counted the black people on the sidewalk recording me so I could go viral. Like, when we had St. Martin, and for him Trayvon, will you come home and rob my pregnant girlfriend? Rob my pregnant girlfriend. I miss you.
Vouched and every leftist are receiving, they're crying.
Don't waste your time on me, you're
already
the voice
inside my head. I can't believe leftists defend that despicable fucking prick George Floyd.
George Floyd, don't waste your time on me, you're already the voice inside my head. George Floyd. We miss you because it's the 2050s and we're George Floyd conservatives.
The serfs are crying.
This is a song called Subscribe to the Channel. This is the campfire when we have the compound. We do a little subscribing to the channel, turning on post notifications, sharing the video with a friend, leaving a like, and also leaving a comment. If you want this, that was so esoteric. This is actually the most esoteric outro in the history of the channel.
I'm overdosing on autism.
We have to get more esoteric with the two-minute outro. You have to know the case. Should I ruin it? I'll ruin it because that makes it more esoteric. Because sometimes I don't ruin it, so we have to add an additional layer of esotericism. So you have to know the case details. Well, first of all, you have to be familiar with the concept of the 2-minute outro. Then you have to be familiar with the case details of the George Floyd thing. Then you have to be familiar with that song by Blink 182. Then you have to be familiar with Tom DeLonge leaving Blink, going on a tour with Angels and Airwaves in the summer and fall of 2019, doing a medley where he played a bunch of songs, starting with the I Miss You acoustic version. There's just so many things that you just have to know. You really just have to take all these things into account for it to make sense. It's really kind of a high IQ thing. You kind of have to have a high IQ to really understand what that whole thing was about. It was kind of meta in a way, which I don't care to explain right now because we're approaching probably the 3.5-minute outro.
Okay. Okay, I rate this video probably a 6 out of 10. Very good, but just a couple of takes that were fucking terrible. I think there was a subliminal Red Eagle diss. I disavow. And second of all, the World War II thing, like, what the fuck? That is ridiculous. Okay, so 6 out of 10. Okay. Anyways, I'm going to leave now. All right. 3, 2, 1, bye.